Hey everyone, special treat. This video I am actually recording on June 10th, and it should be uploading, or it should be publishing on the 13th. So this is out of order. Like the video that's publishing before this, I don't know which direction to point. Before this was recorded in April, and the one that will publish after this also was recorded in April. I'm trying to do the thing where I have a regular upload schedule, and so that's why things are spaced out and queued up. But why is this one? Why the special occasion of uploading out of order? Well, as you know, there are a lot of protests going on. There have been and continue to be, basically protesting for justice for Black lives. I think that's a pretty good summary of what the protests are all about. It is a shame that it took the loss of yet another innocent Black life for it to come to this, but despite the unfortunate circumstance, I am thankful that so many people are starting to really see with clear eyes, finally, just like all the racial injustice that America is built on, and how we're like not that great, because how great can a society be if it is built on the backs of slaves? Anyway, so I thought it would be a good time to review Ben and Jerry's Justice Remixed, as well as share a lot of the resources that I have been sharing on other platforms, mainly Instagram and Twitter, verbally by reading them to you. I will link everything in the caption so that you can click on them and read them yourself. Just like referencing back on them, and also maybe like liking, retweeting, and whatever to support the people who had these thoughts and created these resources. Okay, I'm gonna get the ice cream now because it's in the freezer. And it's been a while since I actually got the ice cream right out of the freezer to eat, so it didn't melt. Anyway, that's not as important, but I'm gonna get the ice cream now. All right, so quick interlude to introduce this ice cream before I say more and share about these resources. So, Justice Remixed from Ben and Jerry's. It is cinnamon and chocolate ice creams with gobs of cinnamon bun dough and spicy fudge brownies. Good stuff. Let me read it. So it says, Advancement Project, now serving Justice Remixed, the flavor and action campaign dedicated to criminal justice reform. We're proud to work with Advancement Project National Office in supporting reforms that invest in people instead of prisons. Good stuff. Together, we can transform the system to deliver justice for all, instead of just for some. Join us at benjerry.com/justice. Yeah, like, that's also a great description. Like, justice for all, instead of just for some. That's chef's kiss. Man, Ben and Jerry's. So, Why am I assigned to become political on my YouTube channel that has like this many? I mean, I appreciate everybody subscribing, but you know, no platform is too small to, that smells good, you know, advocate for social justice. Also, there were some tweets that I really liked. This one from Shay the Scholar that said, some of y'all did a cost-benefit analysis on speaking up and determined it was better or safer for you to be silent. Here's the thing though, silence has a very distinct loudness. It's one that we will never forget. So true. Also, if you know me, I'm big on cost-benefit analyses. I didn't do this cost-benefit analysis. It's just like, I don't really post super regularly on YouTube, and I couldn't find a way to like post like a status update. I've seen some people do that. I did update the caption of the most recent video before this though. Also, Blair Imani? I'm sorry if I'm mispronouncing her name, but she also posted a tweet that said, If y'all are losing followers because you're speaking up about injustice, ask yourself why you haven't been making content that makes racists feel comfortable in the first place. Good food for thought. And so those, I don't want to make content that makes racists feel comfortable. So if you're a racist, I unsubscribe, whatever. It's not like I get money off of this anyway. So let's see. Man, if this strips on my computer, it's okay. My computer's been through a lot. Mmm! The cinnamon! Oh, I like this. This is good. Mmm. I just got one of those gobs of cinnamon bun dough. Ooh, no, I think that was the spicy fudge brownie. Oh, it's kind of spicy. Mmm. Mmm, that's good. Mmm. 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 Mmm, it's very good. When I saw this, I saw that it was Justice Remix, so, like, Wow. I mean, not that I expect bad flavors from Ben & Jerry's, but it's so good when ice cream that's, like, explicitly for good, explicitly promoting good causes also is, like, super delicious. As you know, I really like the Mayan chocolate, the other cinnamon chocolate ice cream that Haagen-Dazs had, but no longer has. Oh, that's a shame because this is also a limited batch. I should buy some more. Not like I have 11 pints of ice cream in the freezer, but you know. Anyway, here's another tweet. This one's from I'm gonna start talking about privilege now. So this one is from Mr. Ahmed Noor Ali. It says, "It's a privilege to learn about racism instead of experiencing it your whole life." I mean, I don't need to talk about my experiences because it's not about me. I am a non-black person of color. I'm not gonna say I haven't experienced prejudice, but it's just completely different than the racism that black people experience. Anyway, so I'm going to read. This is from Courtney on Design. It is a guide to white privilege. It's very pretty. I highly suggest that you check it out. It's very beautiful, and it presents data in a pleasing way. Where did it go? It's like really small here. Technical difficulties. Okay, I'm going to read some of it. So number one, this is specifically talking about white privilege. White privilege doesn't mean your life hasn't been hard. It means your skin tone isn't one of the things making it harder. There's plenty of other privileges, socioeconomic, male, heterosexual, cisgender, Christian, able-bodied, but white privilege is perhaps the most enduring throughout history. Two, white privilege exists as a direct result of both historic and enduring racism, biases, and practices designed to oppress people of color. And then there's like a little illustration, which I'll let you look up and look at yourself. Three, white privilege means you actively benefit from the oppression of people of color. Ooh, spicy gob of fudge. Four, systemic racism exists at every level of society. What should I do with my white privilege if you are white? But also, even if you are a non-black person of color, you also have privilege. You have non-black privilege. So things you can do with your white privilege or with your privilege. Teach other white or non-black folks the barriers to success for people of color or to black people. To promise to listen and amplify the voices of black people and people of color. Be more than not racist, but actively anti-racist. And four, confront racial injustices even when it's uncomfortable. So, good start. These spicy fudge brownies are really good. I don't think I've hit any gobs of cinnamon bun dough yet, though. I know it's probably in the cinnamon part. Well, it's pretty spicy. Like, I'm really weak with spice, though, so. Alright, here's a tweet from Dwayne Reed, whose Twitter handle is Teach Mr. Reed. The tweet is, "White supremacy won't die until white people see it as a white issue they need to solve rather than a black issue they need to empathize with." This is like good conditioning. Like, I already believe all the things that I'm saying, but linking it up with delicious ice cream is forming good neural pathways. Maybe you should do the same. Maybe you should like grab some ice cream and watch this so that you know, social justice is associated with delicious ice cream. Of course, like a charm. This is really good. Oh, I think I just had some. Was that some of the gall of cinnamon bun dough? I'm sure. All right, so like, what do we do? Like, sure, we know about privilege, we know that there's an issue, but like, what can you actually do? So here's a tweet from Robin Faith. She's an actress. I think she's on, what's it called? Spicy fudge brownie? I don't remember which TV. Oh, Black Lady Sketch Comedy Show? I don't know. I watched it though. It was very funny. I cannot remember what it's called. Anyway, her tweet says, "Non-black folks included, here's something small you can learn and do that will go a long way. If you're about to write or say the phrase people of color, stop and think who you're really talking about. If you mean black, say black with a capital B." And then her next tweet is, "And if you actually mean people of color, then by all means say that. It's fine. I'm just asking you to examine your intentions so that black people aren't erased in discussions specifically meant for us." I am not a black person. So it's really easy to just feel uncomfortable about being like, oh, like, I don't want to say black people, but like, if you mean black people, say black people. But usually if you mean it and you just say people of color or POC, people know anyway. Yo! I think I hit a bit of cinnamon bun. That is very cinnamony. So the gobs are like in other Ben & Jerry's when there's a cookie dough. It's not a gooey gob. If you encounter something very gooey, it's probably the spicy fudge brownie. Yeah, the spicy fudge brownie. But if you encounter, when I encounter the next gob of cinnamon bun dough, I'll be sure to pull it out. Anyway, so more action items. Like, let's say there's a lot of people just talking about this right now. So here are some conversational tips. This is really good. Both this social justice work and also this ice cream. So this is from Rita, and I will spell her last name, YAKIBONGE, on Instagram. I don't know why I'm advertising for this company that did not give me a job. All right, how to refocus the conversation on what's important. Hashtag Black Lives Matter. So if somebody says, wow, have you seen the news? You can say, yeah, isn't it incredible how the country is coming together to demand justice? If someone says, I totally get why you're protesting, but not all cops are bad. You can say, true, but neither are all black people. Yet, cops more often than not treat them that way. That's why we protest. I'll have some ice cream to that. Mmm. So good. All of this. If someone says, sheesh, the looting is out of control, you can say, yeah, but looters are the minority. I wish the media would focus more on all of the positive, peaceful protests. If they say, I wish they didn't resort to violence, you can say, you mean the cops? And like, that is, as people say, the tea, or as I say, the ice cream. I don't say that. Now, here's another resource shared by Waste Free Marie, also on Instagram. It is how to respond to common racist statements. If they say, I don't see color, we are all one human race. You can say, wow, we are all human and biologically the same. The systemic oppression of black people makes my experiences vastly different from yours. The systemic oppression of black people makes black people's experiences vastly different from yours. To say that you don't see race, I'm just gonna read this from the perspective of somebody who is black, because that is the quote. The quote is from a black person. Excuse me. It makes it less confusing. So, excuse me. While we are all human and biologically the same, the systemic oppression of black people makes my experiences vastly different from yours. To say that you don't see my race means you don't see my oppression, my marginalization, or the discrimination I'm facing daily. This diminishes my suffering and excuses you from your responsibility to be anti-racist. You must see race to combat racism. I think I'm going to eat until I hit a cinnamon gob. So it's getting melty. I'm in this household. We do not like melty ice cream. Actually, I'm gonna put this in the freezer and come back for it. Chocolate on my face. I do. Okay. Okay. Continuing on with this. If they say, you think something I said was racist, you must have misunderstood me. You can say, well, from a black person perspective, when individuals perpetuate racism, it's usually unintentional. You may have had good intentions. Still, racist acts are defined by their impact, not their intent. Give black people the benefit of the doubt when we call out racism. Rather than suggesting we lack understanding or intelligence, listen and learn from us about how to confront racist ideologies. If they say, I'm not a racist person, you can say, this good non-racist people versus bad racist people, binary concept is a gross oversimplification of what racism is. Racism is oftentimes subconscious, undetected, and born out of privilege or apathy. Racism isn't just in bad people's minds. Racism affects all people who belong to a racialized society. Put more effort into learning how to be anti-racist than you put into convincing others you're non-racist. If they say, I'm not responsible for what my ancestors did, am I supposed to feel bad about that? You can say, we are living in a society that was built on the backs of black people for the benefit of white people. Generational wealth, prosperity, and opportunity benefit white people. Recognize that injustice didn't stop with our ancestors. White people are presently benefiting from the very systems that marginalize black people. Feel convicted to reconcile today's injustices. If they say, as a white person, I'm discriminated against because of reverse racism. You can maybe don't respond like that. That's just me having a visceral response to people I know who have said this kind of thing. But I am also learning how to respond. Here is the response in here. Racism requires both prejudice and power. You may face prejudice. That's not racism because your race is in power. The criminal justice system favors white people, social institutions favor white people and white culture, and internalized prejudices attribute favorable traits to white people. White people are irrefutably in the place of power, so reverse racism cannot exist. And then this question. Why do you make everything about race? You can say, everything in our society is blanketed with white supremacy, which is the notion that whiteness is the norm, the standard, or the ideal. Blackness is regarded as abnormal, substandard, and not ideal. White supremacy covers every facet of our society, but it often goes unnoticed by those it benefits. To better recognize your privilege, take notice of oppression that you don't experience. If somebody says, all lives matter. Response. All lives can't matter until Black lives matter. All lives matter overlooks systemic injustice plaguing the Black community. All lives matter has been weaponized to silence the cries of the unheard. All lives matter promptly ends progress before it starts. To work toward equity for all people, we must start with advocacy for the most marginalized. Whew. If someone says, yikes. So this is kind of like transitioning to another sort of response. So, yikes, I've said these things without realizing that they're racist. Microaggressions and covert racism are oftentimes unintentional, regardless of your intentions. Accept and understand your error. Recognize racial inequalities. Confront your internalized prejudices by learning more about racism. Someone says, but I still feel like I don't know enough to say the right things, which, like, it's kind of me, which is why I'm referencing people who are much smarter than I am in these areas. Anyway, here's something you can say. Listen to Black stories, learn about racial injustice, amplify Black voices, and act. Yes, that's what I am amplifying, Black voices, and acting, and learning, and listening, all good things. Anyway, so that is the end of Waste Free Marie's resource on how to respond to common racist statements, and also statements that might be said in response to these responses to the racist statements. All right, I want to dig in a little bit more on All Lives Matter and why that is problematic. There are like a million, bazillion, gajillion like metaphors and like comparisons of explaining why All Lives Matter is problematic, but I'm gonna read this one just in case you haven't, on the off chance that you haven't seen or heard one yet, and you've made it this far into this video, which, like, great. If you are both of those things, thank you for watching still. Excuse me. So this is from Mabel Abraham. This is like, okay, it's text. It's like a screenshot of her Instagram story because I think a lot of people resonated with it, so she posted it from in her feed. So it says, for my All Lives Matter folks. When the Boston Marathon was bombed, everybody's profile picture went Boston strong. Nobody said, all cities are strong. When Las Vegas shooting happened, people changed their profile. Stand with Vegas. Nobody says, well, what about the people that got shot in my city? Have you ever seen someone counter a breast cancer post with, what about colon cancer? But for some reason, if someone says Black Lives Matter, it turns into all-inclusive, all lives matter. It's not an either-or proclamation. When there is a crisis, we have always rallied around that particular group. it doesn't discredit or diminish any other group. It just brings awareness and support to the group that needs attention. Yes. Yes. Other thing. Okay, now this one is a little bit more personal. If you are Asian American or even just Asian, not American, just Asian. If you're Asian, this one is something that will be particularly relevant to you, as it was particularly relevant to me. So obviously I am Asian. I have Asian parents. Well, I guess it's not a given that I have Asian parents. I guess I could be adopted by non-Asian parents, but, or I guess you could be someone who is adopted by Asian parents and are not Asian yourself. So many possibilities. I will not assume. Anyway, this is a graphic from, I think, Michelle Tam. Her Instagram is mtamdoesart. And it is explaining Black Lives Matter to Asian parents. A difficult conversation. I'm going to start reading it now. The current riots and violence are a result of countless peaceful protests that haven't worked, in anger towards the racist American justice system that continues to let Black people be murdered unjustly. George Floyd, Ahmaud Arbery, Breonna Taylor, Alton Sterling, Tamir Rice, Sandra Bland, and countless others. As part of the model minority, we have a duty to support Black people and be educated and informed. Black Lives Matter is not undermining their struggles as an Asian immigrant and does not mean other lives don't matter. But right now, we need to support Black people. We can help by openly voicing our opinions, supporting Black Lives Matter, donating to justice funds, and voting. So I guess that last part is not necessarily like to, that's like to you, person with Asian parents, or to me, a person with Asian parents. So it's just, it's nice. All right. Now more action. So that's like a lot of talk, but it's like, but are you gonna walk the walk? Well, I personally believe in defunding the police. I know, a little bit radical to some, maybe not that radical though. As this tweet from Coach TJ McKay says, defunding the police sounds radical until you realize we've been defunding education for years. Yeah, so it's not actually that wild of an idea to want to defund the police. And then this is a little bit police adjacent. This has to do with how the protests line, like how they intermingle with COVID, because we are still in the middle of a pandemic. Even though it seems like things are returning more to normal, we still don't have a vaccine, like a proven vaccine. So anyway, this is a tweet thread from Hell on Wheels. Well, actually her, that's like the display name, but the actual handle is Roll W, like with the punches. When the COVID numbers spike, and they will, instead of blaming protesters, take note of which cities used the most unlawful force. Did they, trap protesters between two highways like cattle and then gas them? Did they mow down large groups of people? Did they specifically use tear gas, making people cough, gag, spit, and cry all over their neighbors? Did they entrap them, impose a sudden curfew, and then start firing to create a stampede? Did they walk by and yank masks down before macing or spraying them? Did they charge upon seated protesters, making them have to climb on top of each other just to get to safety? Did they aim rubber bullets at the face, highly vascular areas that would lead to excessive bleeding? Or were they reasonable and let everyone keep their distance? Everyone masked, keep their distance. That's how you'll know who to blame. That's why some states will skyrocket to the top while others maintain growth. Maintain, because like, it's not over yet, even outside of protests. When you look at the data or new condition of your state, ask yourself what the force use looked like. It's been egregious everywhere, but some weaponized COVID. Also, if you missed why we're not blaming protesters, under any circumstance for the inevitable spread of COVID anyway, let's take a trip back. And then there's another tweet quoted, which let's dive in. All right. So this is kind of sort of a family friendly YouTube channel, so I'm gonna censor a little bit. Before anyone can say a in word, if COVID cases spike, and they will, I don't want to hear one person blame the protesters, and certainly not black folks. Want to blame someone? Blame Derek Chauvin and his three racist buds. Blame Greg and Travis McMichael. Blame Amy Cooper. Blame the Minneapolis Police Department. Blame George Zimmerman and every murderous cop whose name doesn't even deserve my energy to type. Blame our instigating president. Blame the apologists and everyone who took issue with the infinite forms of peaceful protest anyone tried before this. They are responsible for forcing thousands to protest in the middle of a pandemic just to save lives, black lives. To not let this go quietly and be forgotten like every human life termed hashtag of the last 6 years. They caused a COVID spike because these people would rather be home. They'd rather be safe inside. But wait, black folks aren't safe at home. Not in kitchens or sleeping beds. No, even so, trust, everyone would much rather know they are safe and are protecting themselves and others' lives. Oh wait, that's what the protest is for. And guess what? You wanna know who's the most at risk of another COVID surge? Black folks. They already had the largest death disparity, and the data is appalling. Because of poverty, neglect, wrongful imprisonment, because of racism. So I don't wanna hear a single word about the protests hurting you. The threat to their lives, not just from rubber bullets, gassing, being run over, or beaten, all to protect lives already threatened at home, on jogs, on playing in a park, is still exponential to the risk you face if you both get COVID. And trust me, I do understand the fear. I'm disabled and COVID will kill me. I'm terrified watching this too, knowing what's coming, petrified. But I will in no universe blame or fault protesters for this. Most came masked, gloved, calm, and distanced. Many only failed to once shot at, gassed, or run over. Most did everything they could to protect those around them and only ever put others at risk when involuntarily thrown to the ground, spit on, stampeded, or bad faith rioting began. Protesters are not to blame. Racism is. Murder is. Police brutality is. Injustice is. It's okay to be scared, feel vulnerable, or upset seeing a pandemic spread in real time, but focus your outrage. Be devastated they even had to protest during a pandemic. Be sad tear gas was ever considered amidst a pulmonary crisis. Be scared of the medical neglect they'll face. Be terrified and upset they'll be blamed for a country going back to lockdowns when no one kept the same outrage for armed, unmasked COVID protesters. And then make sure you never direct blame their way yourself. Direct it at the oppressors who caused this. They caused us all. But most of all, they cost black folks. Full stop. Remember who the real enemy is. Whew. So that's protesting and defunding the police and COVID. I'm gonna grab my ice cream again and finish up on fail funds. So I know I started like sharing these resources talking about cost-benefit analyses. Well, the first time was talking about the cost-benefit analysis of, you know, talking about this sort of thing. But now, as I mentioned in my caption of my previous video, which I edited, it's so good. I'm directing most of my donation dollars towards bail funds, because they're just very cost effective. I love optimization. I love this spicy. Oh! Alright, sorry. I found a cinnamon dough gob. It's, I don't know, it's just, you can't really tell because it's like dough that's frozen, but you will know that it looks like this. If you come across like a little harder bit, that is the cinnamon. Do they call them cinnamon? Oh no, cinnamon bun dough. Oh, there's no gobs. Oh yeah, gobs of cinnamon bun dough. That's so good. Wow, I really like cinnamon. I'm so glad cinnamon has like health benefits. I mean, when paired with this much sugar, it's not really a health benefit, but whatever. Anyway. My sensitive teeth. The coldness got to me. Alright. Here's a tweet on bail funds from Nino Cipri. I don't know how to it's NINOCIPRI. Alright. A quick thread on how community bail funds work, because one, they're awesome, and two, a lot of folks are probably donating to them or maybe hearing about them for the first time, which is also awesome. Supporting protesters is good and necessary work, but they do so much more. This spicy fudge brownie is so good. Alright. The best and most accessible breakdown on how revolving bail funds work I found is from the Chicago Bond Fund. And there's a link in that tweet. So, how bail works. Wait, do I have chocolate in my teeth? Not right now. Anyone arrested for a felony and some misdemeanors is sent to bond court, and an amount of money is set for their release. This money is left with the court, and its return is contingent on the person arrested making all of their court dates. And remember, at the justice system, often works on timescales of months and years. Bail is usually in the thousands or tens of thousands of dollars. There are guidelines and algorithms for setting bail, but it's often arbitrary and usually completely at the discretion of a judge. Individuals charged with the same crime can face wildly different bails, depending on how trustworthy the judge deems you within a few minutes. Cinnamon is so good. So imagine, you've been arrested, left overnight or all weekend in a holding cell, signed an overworked public defender who has dozens of other clients, and have to prove that you are absolutely trustworthy in a matter of minutes to a stranger disinclined to believe you. Most felony bails are set at $10,000. And then there's a link in the citation. If you can't suddenly magic up $10,000, you can use a bail bond, which is usually 10% off the bail. Commercial bail bonds are non-returnable. You'll never see that $1,000 again if you and your family can scrape it together at all. And if you can't, you'll stay in jail for months or years until trial, or, very unlikely, your case is somehow dropped. Or you can plead guilty. A lot of people plead guilty. Keep in mind, you might be the sole breadwinner of your family. You might be the sole parent to your kids, caretaker to an ill family member. Cash bail is inherently biased against the poor, Black, and Indigenous people, women, and people of color. It's poison. Community bail funds replace the commercial bail bonds industry. They pay a bail bond without charging 10% and work with their members to navigate the labyrinth justice system. They advocate for bail and carceral reform and nearly all have prison abolition as an end goal. The great part is, once that person's trial is over, the money is returned to the bail fund and can be used to get the next person out of jail. Donating to them now gets protesters dealing with mass arrests out of prison immediately. It'll also free someone in the future, too. If you are white and you aren't poor, you probably have never had to think about how the carceral system really sets up Black, Indigenous, people of color, women, and poor folks to fail. This is an excellent opportunity to learn and support the people who are organizing to change it. The peace emoji. For the record, I'm not an expert on this, and I've never been arrested, though I've supported friends and a partner who has been. If any of this is wrong, please correct me and I'll add to the thread. Oh, and then there's a correction here. One correction. The median bail for a felony in the United States is $10,000. Not the average and definitely not majority. It really is a complete crapshoot, with the scales tipped depending on race, age, location, and the politics of your judge. This is super informative. Link in there. And you absolutely should, if you can, I guess, donate to a bail fund. Even regular small donations can do a lot of good. You should also support other prison abolition programs, as well as orgs like RICES Texas that bail people out of immigration detention. I have another video about when I talked about them in the half-baked review. And I can't believe I didn't include this before, but here's a list of 60 community bail funds. Link. I'm also gonna plug the LGBTQ Freedom Fund in particular. So, those are the resources I want to share. This is like maybe my longest video. Actually, I think my old like haul video is probably longer, but I don't know why people watch haul videos. I just made one because I bought a bunch of stuff online and was like, I guess I'll record this. That was a big thing of spicy fudge brownie. Wow, that's so good. Oh. Ooh. That's some cinnamon. I don't know if you made it here. I'm gonna explain some things. This, my fading tattoos, I talked about them in some of the videos that we'll be uploading later because I record them before now, but you know, the queue. Also, if you got here, let me know. Comment below your favorite resource that I shared. And if you do that, okay, comment your favorite resource you shared and also an ice cream flavor you'd like to see me review or your favorite ice cream. Comment those two things and I will donate and think about this form. I'll donate $5, an additional $5 to, I'll donate $5 to a bail fund of your choice. I guess leave a comment for that one. If you don't have a preference, then I'll just donate to the one, to the big one that I talked about in my last caption. So yeah. Your favorite resource, what else can you like to see me review, or that, or either that or your favorite ice cream, and a bail fund that you'd like me to donate to. I'll donate $5 to that fund, and if you don't specify one, then I'll just do the national one. I'm just watching. Ooh, the cinnamon bundle was so good. Ben and Jerry's, you go. Get it before, actually it's a really good thing that this is, I'm posting this like now because it is a limited batch. If I post this in like 2 months, 3 months, well, it might still be around in like 2 or 3 months, but I don't know, sometimes I get really behind. Check out that cinnamon dough, cinnamon but wait. Yeah, cinnamon bundle gum. I don't know if you can really call it a gob if it's been solidified, but it's delicious, so. Look how much I've eaten. It's just like, here, let's do some math. This much, like over half. It's a lot. It's good though, it's very good. It's like 500 calories. That's fine. I've been losing weight this quarantine. Time to gain it back. I think I am getting it back though. It's good. This is so good. Okay. It's like the condensation is dripping. Thanks for watching. Hope you got this far, because then you can comment and then I can like give more money to bail funds. Love it. Oh, I guess I'll also cap it at like 20. No, I may cap it. I'll just comment if I cap it in the caption, because I don't have infinite dollars, but I also don't have infinite viewers. So, you know, it goes both ways. Okay, bye.